Hey folks, today we have a complete real-world early review of the new Samsung Galaxy Watch 5 Pro. Now, I've been putting it through its paces, everything from a hard interval workout, including into the deep cities to test GPS, looking at the new routing and backtrack functionality, out hiking, as well as checking out how things like battery life claims hold up and all that kind of goodness. So we're gonna dive into all those new features, especially the pro ones and plenty more. Note that I've put YouTube chapters along the bottom on there so you can skip ahead to the section that you want. Also note, this video is definitely not sponsored. After the keynote, I went ahead and just simply ordered it myself and then also simply just picked it up this morning at the store, which is probably a whole different funny video for another day. But for now, I've got the Pro here and I've been putting through its paces, like I said. Keep in mind, I will do a full in-depth review down the road here once I've got much more detail and data on things like the battery life and the sleep tracking longer term. So definitely hit the subscribe button so you don't miss on that here in a couple weeks. Now, for those of you that are unfamiliar with the Pro Edition, I'll spend like 60 seconds here to kind of give you the quick landscape, and then we're gonna go straight into the features. So there are two editions of the Samsung Galaxy Watch 5. There's the Pro and there's the Non-Pro. And so this one here starts at $279. It comes in two different sizes, 40 and 44 mil. And then this one here is at $449 and it comes in a 45 mil. From a material standpoint, the Pro has a titanium case. They both have a sapphire crystal display in it, which is usually more scratch resistant. But the Pro has a better sapphire crystal display. It has a 29 GPA versus the 24 GPA on the regular unit. The Pro also has this new clasp system on there versus the regular one does not. Samsung says both editions have a completely revamped sensor suite, including the ECG, heart rate, as well as body composition sensors. We're gonna test all those things, but in this video, we're gonna test in particular the optical heart rate side of it. They've also added a body temperature sensor, but that's only for sleeping at night. It'll go ahead and measure your body temperature then. And then all these editions have GPS as well as Wi-Fi and Bluetooth built into them. And then some editions have LTE for direct cellular connectivity. Probably the biggest hardware difference between these two editions is the bigger battery. So the base 40 unit comes with a 284 milliamp hour battery. The 44 comes with a 410 milliamp hour battery. And then the Pro Edition, that's 45 mil, comes with a 590 milliamp hour battery. And Samsung says, with that, the Pro Edition should get up to 20 hours of GPS on time and up to 80 hours of just regular smartwatch standby time. And then to charge that bigger battery, there's a new charging cable. That cable can go from 0 to 45% in 30 minutes, which is pretty impressive. And then it can also go from 0 to 8 hours of sleep tracking in 8 minutes. So just handy in case you get to the end of the day and then realize you're a little bit short to get through the night for the sleep tracking. And then just like with Samsung's Watch 4, this one right here, it comes with Google's Wear OS. So it's going to use that new platform, but it does have a Samsung's One UI system on top of it. But it is though lacking the bezel that you would have had on the older units. That is now gone for just purely a touch bezel, which, you know, kind of works the same way, kind of not really. Also, it's a heck of a lot thicker. Like, just to put these side by side, this is definitely a bit of a beefcake, this Pro unit here. Kind of reminds me of like a cargo ship. It's just, there's no tapering whatsoever on the side right here. So you just look at it and it's just like, boom, I am here and in town. So with that, let's dive straight into the first new features, which is the compass itself. And this is all we focused on the Pro. So this is the compass watch face. I point out this is not the stock or default watch face. You actually have to kind of build this entire thing yourself, which is sort of strange, but whatever. And you'll see as I rotate this here, that north right there changes with that. If we go outside, you can see the exact same thing as well. And this is one of those features that Samsung aligns to that kind of pro thinking, having a compass and a watch face. As far as the accuracy of that, it seems a little bit iffy. Just to kind of illustrate this, this is north right now, so it's gonna be on this side of the table. And if I just do like one rotation of this, now north is over here. And yeah, if I rotate slowly, you can see it sticks there. But it doesn't seem to like be always super accurate. Like it kind of comes and goes. Like I do it again, now the north is over there. But if I rotate too quickly, then yeah, that's not super pro. In any case, let's get on to the actual mapping and navigation. So with the Pro Edition, you have the ability to import a GPX file into the watch and then navigate atop that. So to kind of walk you through how this works, you need to first get a GPX file to the watch itself. So you need to create a GPX file. And there's tons of tools out there to do that. In my case, I use Strava to create the route, and there's an option in Strava to export GPX. Once I did that, I emailed it to myself because I created it on the desktop. So emailed it to myself and then I saved it into my Samsung phone. And then from there, I open up a Samsung Health app. And after that, you dive into the sport mode settings. Then you just fumble around for a while. It's actually not super obvious at all. And it changes depending on which time you open it. The first time it's a different place than it is the second times, but eventually you get to the routes area and then you can open up on the files on your phone and then import that GPX file in. Once you've imported that GPX file into your phone, it'll go ahead and sync it to the watch itself. Now there's two different sport modes that support routing today. One is cycling and the other is hiking. There's no routing support today for running or walking or any other sport modes, just cycling and hiking. And that's consistent with what Samsung has said, like in a PR standpoint, though in their video, they noted marathon.
Rail, marathon, or cycling courses as you.
As someone who marathons occasionally, I don't typically use the cycling sport mode or the hiking sport mode for a marathon, but hopefully that's something that'll get fixed down the road. Also, hopefully this is a great time to whack that like button down there. It really does help with this video and the channel quite a bit. So once you've got it on the watch itself, you're ready to roll. You're gonna swipe a few times over to the menu that shows basically your routes, and you can go ahead and choose the route that you want. The most recent route added to the watch will be the one on the top, but you can look at other routes you have there. You can tap it, you can see a map of it. You can't like pinch and zoom on this particular map, though you can once you start, but you can go ahead and reverse the route, which I appreciate. That's a nice little touch. And then once you're ready, you just simply hit start. At that point, you get the 3 second countdown like usual, and then it'll go off and find GPS. This will take anywhere from like 5 seconds to 45 seconds, depending on where you are and whatnot. And then once that's good, it'll start giving audio prompts of where you need to go. It'll give you turn by turn directions, meaning as you approach a turn about 50 meters out in the case of hiking, it'll say
36 meters from starting point, take the next right.
And then if you miss the turn, like if you just completely ignored, it'll tell you're off course after about 50 meters or so. Note that you do not need your phone for this. I went off on one test hike without my phone at all. I did this just fine. Though keep in mind, you won't get any of the map information saved or cached to the watch without your phone. So you'll just see the track like a breadcrumb trail, but it will give you the off course warnings without your phone just fine. But in terms of having that map layer below it, you need to have your phone with you. You can also tap on the screen if you want to and go ahead and kind of zoom around or move around the map to see where the route is. And then you can reset back to where you are. In terms of like real world usability, I'd say this is fine if you've got like clear sunny day and you can see all the trails around you, know what's going on, but I would definitely not trust this if there's lots of trails and trees that are really close and parallel to each other that maybe you need to be absolutely on one trail or one side of the river or one side of the stream versus the other, because it won't warn you until you're about 50 or so meters off, which think about that's like a half a football field away. And that's quite a ways to be potentially on the wrong trail, especially if like the fork of a trail or something like that, where you may have just gone off and the two trails go parallel for a while. You could be going for quite a while before you found out you're on the wrong trail. So that gets us to the next feature, which is the backtrack ability. This works across the board, so it doesn't seem to be limited to either hiking or cycling, and allows you to backtrack to your starting point. So what you do is you basically swipe to the side, go into settings, and you'll see the backtrack option. When you tap that, it starts tracking back your original course. Now this is following your exact route that you came out to that point in. So it's really ideal for like out and backs where you're going out somewhere and then you say, yep, I'm done, I'm gonna come on back again. It's not good at all for loops or lollipops or figure eights or anything where you just wanna go directly back to start in the shortest manner. This is gonna take you the exact same way you got there, including any errors you made all the way back again. But navigation wise, it's identical to what you had the first time around with regular navigation, except now your endpoint is simply your start point, if that makes sense. So now's a good time to talk about the running side and that new biometric suite. Samsung says they have a new biometric suite here that includes a new optical heart rate sensor. It looks pretty much identical to the existing optical heart rate sensor, but maybe there's some differences inside of it. Nonetheless, I was gonna go out and do a bit of a comparison, an interval run, if you will. The run would start off as steady state, and then every 2 kilometers, I'd throw down a hard interval to kind of push that optical heart rate sensor. For comparison, on the other wrist, I had an Apple Watch Series 7 running the new watchOS 9 beta. I also had a chest strap on. And then further, I had the Whoop 4.0 optical heart rate band up there, as well as the Oura Ring here, also recording. So I had a lot of data from a heart rate standpoint being recorded. And then on the GPS side of things, I had the Garmin Forerunner 955 GPS watch being handheld, as well as the Coros Vertex 2. All those watches were properly separated out, so only one watch worn per wrist, otherwise you can impact optical heart rate. And then they were separated out on the hands so that I don't have any impacts to GPS either. Finally, from a route standpoint, the route started off kind of easy on a path, and then I got into some more tree cover, and then I went to like downtown building hell. Basically three sweeps up and down of the business district on different streets here in Amsterdam. So really tall buildings, very, very close together, only about two lanes width between them, just to really test out this to the max. And then after that, I finished back in the trees again. So starting off with the optical heart rate side of things, you can see it gets off to a bit of a slow start, like it's just kind of like waking up first run, just lagging behind a little bit. But after a couple minutes, it locks on. And honestly, it was fine for pretty much the rest of the run. Towards the end of the run, I did four hard intervals, like really hard intervals, full flat out intervals. And you can see it lagged a little bit there, but certainly better than the whoop strap and overall pretty good. So overall in this first interval run, pretty decent on the optical heart rate. I have no like major qualms with this at all. So let's switch over to the GPS side of things. So you can see here, as we get going on this path, it's pretty straightforward. It's definitely the least accurate of the group. It's just kind of like wobbling a little bit. It's not like horrible. It's not bad. It's just not like, it's not really spot on. And that mostly remains the case the entire time until we got to the city. Once we got to the city though, it's definitely wobbling around and going through a lot of buildings. It's not nearly as accurate as a multi-band on the 400 955 is, but it didn't have the complete and total meltdown that the Apple Watch Series 7 did. And it's notable, this is the first time I've ever seen in 7 years an Apple Watch meltdown as badly as it did here in this section on this run. And I had neither phone for the Apple Watch or the Samsung Watch with me, so was not using my phone for GPS. Both of those phones were at home, so that was not gonna leverage that in any way, shape, or form. Once I got out of the district area, the Apple Watch snapped back to reality, so I'm not really sure what's going on there. As you can see, the Samsung Watch track throughout that is kind of like, man, not great, but not horrendous. It's just sort of like, whatever. But overall, it wasn't a dumpster fire, which is sometimes like the bar for success. So what about battery life? So in this case, I basically took it straight off the charger. It was 100% off the charger, went outside. So let's just call it 99% at the start of the run. When I got back, it was at 91%. So we'll call it like 9%, 8-9% for the fun of it. Now in this case, the run took me about 50 minutes. So if we extrapolate that out, you're looking at roughly 10 hours of GPS battery time for the Pro Edition. Samsung is claiming 20 hours. And in my case for the run, I didn't even have the always on display on at all. It just simply was in the timeout mode automatically. So basically the best case scenario there. So we're basically like half of the battery claim, but I wanna kind of see how this rolls over the next couple weeks. In terms of like daily usage, at this point, it's too early to say. I would say it's trending more towards like a strong 2.5 days than it is the 3.5 days that Samsung is advertising with 80 hours. But like I said, I will keep on looking at the battery aspects over the next couple weeks, especially if there's any software updates. This one did have its software update this morning, so it is on the freshest current version of software that's out there. In terms of the Pro moniker, and might be a bit of a stretch. We've seen many companies add Pro to not just their watches, but also other consumer products. Even Apple is rumored to be doing it for the Apple Watch Series 8. If I look at the features that it considers Pro here, mainly like that basic kind of breadcrumb trail routing, as well as the ability to do backtrack or trackback, neither of those are really too pro in the running watch world. There have been watches down to like even $150 GPS running watches from TomTom and Polar and others that have those features for almost the better part of a decade. Still, there are plenty of other features on the Samsung watches that would be considered more pro, but those features are indeed on the base edition as well. So I'm looking forward to seeing what Samsung can add to this watch over the next year and firmware updates that gives it that kind of pro feeling, given not just the higher end price, but simply the name Pro. Anyways, hopefully you found this interesting or useful. If so, go ahead and whack that like button at the bottom there or subscribe for plenty more sports technology goodness. I think we got a pretty busy fall. I think it's gonna be good times ahead in not just the wearables realm, but the sport tech realm as well. Have a good one.